I think the individuals with mild cases of COVID really need to, you know, realize that the outcome for the majority of individuals is very good. A small percentage of individuals that have long-lasting symptoms. And there are multiple reasons why that individual may have multiple symptoms and long-standing symptoms. And that's what the neuropsychologist can help tease apart to get an understanding of what is leading to the continuation of those symptoms.
All right, welcome. Today, we are pleased to have Dr. Brad Merker. He is a clinical neuropsychologist, and he is the division head of neuropsychology at Henry Ford Hospital. And he also runs the post-ICU and neuropsychological complication unit. And he is a very active member of our post-COVID recovery program. So welcome, Dr. Merker, and thank you for coming and joining us.
Good afternoon. Thanks for having me.
Thank you. So, Dr. Merker, so would you like to tell us how would you describe the neuropsychological complications after COVID?
You know, I think the best way to talk about the complications would be to break it down into the concerns related to individuals' thinking, which often include problems paying attention, concentrating, with memory, or with what we call executive functioning, meaning they have difficulties with reasoning, problem solving, organizing, planning. And then other individuals often report, you know, the common symptom of brain fog or periods of confusion. So those are the typical neuropsychological cognitive complications related to COVID. In terms of the psychological complications, we tend to see anxiety, depression, and trauma. And a lot of those symptoms can be due to just fear of having COVID and the outcome. Individuals that have had COVID and are in the ICU can experience symptoms of PTSD as well, due to their stay and, again, the complications from a severe illness. Other people with more milder forms of COVID can also experience, you know, obsessive compulsive kind of behaviors, some panic, and then other complaints tend to be sleep issues and fatigue.
So it seems that there is a whole wide range of complications and symptoms that people come out after COVID-19 infection. And that, you know, I do see all of those in my neurology clinic. Some people have like a life-threatening condition or the experience is bad. So from your experience in the post-ICU recovery, what is the difference between post-ICU complications that people are intubated and being in the ICU for a long time, and what you see post-COVID-19 complications?
Well, you know, there's a lot of similarities between the post-ICU patients and the patients that just have COVID and are treated either in a regular hospital unit floor or even being treated at home. You know, like you mentioned, the post-ICU folks have a lot more medical complications, and those tend to lead to additional organ failures, things like that, which can superimpose the effects of COVID on their neuropsychological functioning. You know, for example, the post-ICU patients can experience delirium or encephalitis, things like that. They can have the trauma from being in the ICU, being isolated, like in the beginning stages of the pandemic, where no family or visitors were allowed. And, you know, you have all the bells and whistles and alarms in the ICU, and that's very traumatizing for some individuals. So, you know, I think in terms of the post-ICU patients, they tend to be more severe. They tend to have more severe cognitive issues. They have more severe psychiatric issues in general. But on the other hand, the post-ICU patients, due to the more severe cognitive deficits that they potentially could have, they also have what we call limited insight or awareness of these deficits. So they may not see these deficits in their cognition themselves, and it's often brought to their attention by a family member or by a medical provider.
Well, that's very interesting, because if you have memory loss, you forget that you forget, right? Like, or you don't have the insight and you just want to go back and do the work or the function that you used to do before, and you're not aware that you cannot do them anymore, or you have troubles with doing that. So when do you recommend to see a neuropsychologist? So what is the best time to get to the evaluation neuropsychologist?
Well, again, I think it really depends on the severity of the COVID disease. And so individuals that are mostly treated at home or, you know, had a brief hospital stay, they should follow up with their primary care physicians as soon as these concerns go on for, 4 to 6 weeks after most of their other symptoms have resolved. So if they have ongoing anxiety, depression, PTSD, or cognitive concerns, their physical health has markedly improved, then it's definitely warranted to follow up with your PCP and seek a referral to a neuropsychologist. For those patients that have more moderate to severe COVID and their complications, either cognitive or psychological, for the psychological patients, once they're on the road to recovery in the ICU, early intervention tends to be the best, if possible. A lot of ICUs, it's not possible to provide that type of treatment. And so then in those cases, those individuals perhaps could get that type of treatment when they get discharged either to home, a skilled nursing facility, or a rehab facility. But, overall, early intervention is the best intervention and typically leads to the best outcome. I think the individuals with mild cases of COVID really need to, realize that the outcome for the majority of individuals is very good. A small percentage of individuals that have long-lasting symptoms. And there are multiple reasons why that individual may have multiple symptoms and long-standing symptoms. And that's what the neuropsychologist can help tease apart to get an understanding of what is leading to the continuation of those symptoms.
Yeah, that will lead us to discuss, what are the testing and evaluations that you would do in your clinic when we refer our patients to see you as a neuropsychologist and evaluation for their memory and language functions?
So typically, the evaluations that we do for the COVID patients are no different than what we do for other patients who have maybe had a stroke, a seizure, a head injury, or are suspected of having dementia. We use the same types of tests. Typically, it might be a little bit of a shorter battery or a more focused battery, but we're going to assess attention, language, memory, visual spatial skills, processing speed, and that higher order cognitive functioning. In addition to that, we're going to look at their mood. We're going to see if there's any depression, anxiety, PTSD, how do they handle stress, what's the impact on their day-to-day activities? Is their quality of life been impacted by COVID? Are they able to work at home? Are they able to work in the office still and complete those day-to-day activities?
So you highlighted always the screening for neuropsychological complications. So when people have psychiatric issues that are often happening with COVID-19 patients, like anxiety, depression, PTSD, do you think that those people have more deficits or more problems with their memory and language functions if they do have that? And what is the impact of treatment of those psychological complications on the outcome?
From what I've seen in the research, we do know that individuals that do have a past psychiatric history before contracting COVID tend to have more psychological or psychiatric problems afterwards. Mm-hmm. And they tend to exacerbate or worsen those pre-existing psychological problems. And we also know just outside of COVID that individuals that have depression, anxiety, PTSD, those conditions themselves cause cognitive problems, such as difficulties with attention, memory, and executive functioning. So whether it's related to the COVID infection or the resulting depression, anxiety, PTSD, those are two potential reasons we want to do the evaluation to sort out what is that underlying cause of their cognitive complaints so that we can get them the appropriate treatment to help resolve those cognitive concerns.
Right. So what are the stories that you have seen in people? So yeah, we say executive dysfunction and all those fancy words as a scientist and neuropsychologist use. So what are the day-to-day functions that are affected that you see in your patients when you evaluate them?
Most commonly the patients are reporting problems paying attention, concentrating, focusing. They feel like mentally slowed down or their head is cloudy. They have difficulties, with everyday problem solving. Something's broke around the house. They can't, come to a conclusion on how to fix it. In terms of memory, maybe they're forgetting where they put something down. They're forgetting something that, a loved one has told them, or they're forgetting that they did something recently, like taking their medications or put something in the oven. Those are the most consistent kind of cognitive complaints that we're seeing.
Yeah, I think of it as the sand in the hand analogy. So what I think, I've seen lots of people with like short-term memory consolidation dysfunction. So when they, so I had a patient that she is trying to follow a cooking recipe. So she will go to the video about cooking, and then like she will go to the kitchen just like 1 minute later, and she forgot the whole thing. Like she could not hold the sand in her hand. She could not hold the memory pieces, and that is like significantly impairing them and their daily functions.
And that's a good point. You know, part of what we do as neuropsychologists is really help tease apart, is this an attention problem? Is it more of a learning problem, or is it more of a memory problem? Because a lot of people can't separate that. They just don't know the differences. But if you don't pay attention to something, then you never learn it. You never remember it. And then 5 minutes later, it's never there for you to pull out because it never got stored in the first place.
And so knowing all of that and getting that comprehensive evaluation, that will give us so much data on what are the dysfunctions and domains of memory and language dysfunction. So how can we use all of that in the treatment of memory and language dysfunction after COVID?
Well, typically, you know, the evaluation will determine whether it's an arousal, an attention, a learning, or a memory problem. And then you can really tailor cognitive rehabilitation to focus on those specific cognitive domains. So, for example, attentional problem will recommend that they, you know, minimize distractions, avoid multitasking, use a notepad, calendar, a pillbox, alarm clock when they're cooking, those types of things, things at a paced activity. So you're only doing one thing at a time to completion. Otherwise, you get off track or distracted. You never finish things. If it's more of a memory problem, then typically we can teach them how to encode things verbally or visually or both. We can teach them how to use strategies like creating acronyms, visual, you know, imagery in terms of ways to store things. And then using, you know, short-term kind of compensatory strategies like a notebook, a calendar, a memory book, those types of things. And your cell phones these days are great external memory devices. So we spend a lot of time talking to patients on how to effectively use, you know, cell phones and the features in the cell phones to act as that kind of external memory device. In terms of language, within our clinic, we don't provide a lot of treatment for language dysfunction. That's better treated by a speech pathologist. So we often recommend that they go follow up with speech pathology for treatment of any, you know, type of word finding difficulties, or other, you know, language-based dysfunction.
Right. That's those are very, very good points that you mentioned. Definitely having lots of auxiliary things to help you, tips and tools to keep organizing your day so that you give time to the brain to heal and not overload it. And yes, we did a whole video with an expert in speech pathology that you guys can check it out. I will link it here in the cards so that for you to review more on speech pathology treatment and tips for recovery of your memory. Those are excellent tips. And is there any advice for patients from the neuropsychologist that you would give for people who are suffering from post-COVID language and memory issues?
Well, I think, like I mentioned at the outset of our talk, really early intervention is the key. There are a lot of reasons why someone can experience cognitive problems or psychological problems, whether it's due to COVID or some other, you know, etiology, meaning cause. It's really up to the neuropsychologist to figure out what that underlying cause is. And then, you know, we can provide the appropriate treatment recommendations, whether that's following up for outpatient psychotherapy, for depression, anxiety, with a psychiatrist, for medication, for anxiety, depression, with sleep medicine, for, you know, ongoing sleep problems and daytime fatigue, which can affect arousal. So really early intervention is the key. Follow up with your primary care physician and then leave it up to your primary care physician to refer over to neuropsychology when it's indicated.
Right. Those are all excellent points. So the neuropsychologist has a powerful tools to kind of pinpoint where the problem is so that it leads to a better treatment for the specific problems that are causing the memory and language dysfunction.
Yeah.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Merker. Your expertise was very, very appreciated. And thank you so much for sharing your experience with others. And for you watching this, we had a whole playlist of multiple other videos on long hauler symptoms of all the long symptoms complications after COVID-19. So you can watch those videos in the playlist to learn more about long hauler symptoms. And see you in the next one.